watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
All right, good morning and welcome to Health Science 395, which we are focusing on health education strategies and instructional resources to use with students both in school and in other settings. This is our third session. I hope you had a nice long weekend last weekend. We had a little break in our action. So we are back in and we'll be in the swing of things now for the next couple of months. I want to just take a few minutes to refresh our memories, think about where we have come from as we've now only been in the session for our third broadcast. But I do want you to kind of keep this in mind every week as we get together. Is what we're doing is we're building on every week and culminating in the next few weeks as we look at various curricula that you might use to promote health behaviors in children, teens, adolescents, maybe even some young adult stuff. But I do want to remind you that this is a participatory class. I hope each of you is logged into the chat room so that you can speak with each other during class about what we are talking about. Please keep in mind, I do not see the chat room, so if you want to make a comment that I can share with others, you'll have to either call in or email. And those the phone number and the email address you'll see pop up throughout our broadcast. And certainly if you have technical issues, you can make a comment in the chat room and those who are monitoring it may be able to help you out some there. Just a little bit of a thank you to each of you as we have gotten started this semester. Thank you for submitting your journal entries in a timely manner. I know that 11:59 deadline is a little tough sometimes, but every Monday by 11:59, you will have another journal entry due to me. Journal entries are kind of a casual way for you and I to check in. I'll ask you some questions, and then if there's anything you ask of me, I will certainly respond to you. They are private. Your peers do not see those communications. While they are casual, let's not get too casual. This is not a text message. I still do anticipate college-level academic writing, so please do keep that in mind. But certainly we have that flexibility of this is a private communication. Your discussion boards, your first assignment was due last week, and I was able to take a look at those. Thank you so much for sharing a little bit about yourselves. Not only who you are and why you are taking this class, but then sharing a little bit about your experiences with children of any age and in a variety of settings. I think, we are a small class, though there is a great deal of energy and enthusiasm and expertise amongst us. So, I think each of you has something that would be a worthwhile contribution. So I'm going to encourage you not just to sit back and listen and watch me, but to actually participate in the discussions. There's my phone number that will come right into the studio, and then there's also an email which will be forwarded to a monitor I have here in front of me. So I can share your comments. And it's it's not quite the class discussion that you have in a face-to-face class, but it is, but it does take some of that place. So thank you for all of that. Okay, well, we've got the question of the day up on the screen. So here is your chance to participate. As you have read so far for modules 1, 2, and 3, and really focusing on what we're going to talk about today, which one or two of the health education content standards do you feel are critical to include as you have interactions with others, and why? And for some of you, you may have a hard time identifying only one or two, and that's okay. But just give me your thoughts about some of the standards and what it is that you think about them and why they are so critical to include. I do want you to keep all of what we talk about today in mind, and remembering back to what we've already discussed in this course. Remember, 2 weeks ago, we really took a look at how the brain learns. And we talked about characteristics of effective health education. So as we go through now today a little bit more about the health education content standards and a little start on curriculum, you can use all of that we've talked about with what we know about neuroscience and learning. So hopefully all of you are thinking about those one or two standards, and you are going to send me an email or give me a call so we can go on. And while you are formulating and doing all of that, I'm just going to get started and share with you some of the content I'd like to reinforce from your readings, from some of the documents I've placed on Blackboard. And I do want to just put out a caveat right here that I know that there are several of you who are here in my 395 course who've just spent the last 2 hours with me in Health Science 300. Today, there is a fair amount of overlap between the two broadcasts. However, toward the end of this broadcast, we will be bringing in new content. So for those of you who've already sat through my Health Science 300, bear with me. I just want you to keep in mind repetition is good for the brain. As we talk a little bit about the health education content standards, and then we'll move on. So bear with us as we do some repetition here between the two courses. Please note that for those of you who are taking both classes, Health Science 300, which broadcasts from 9 to 11, it's really talking more about the health issues. We will identify a few key things from the content standard, but what we'll really start doing, and this starts next week, is looking at curricular resources or effective strategies that you can use in classrooms or in settings with children, teens, adolescents that are effective resources for you. So this course will begin to look more at the curricular end of the issues, and that will be the difference between Health Science 300 and 395. So bear with us today as there is a fair amount of overlap. Okay, so as you're formulating your thoughts about those one or two health education standards, let's just reiterate, go through a few key points. First of all, just answer the age-old question. What is health education? You know, this is a term I've thrown around frequently in the two broadcasts we've had together, and I've done so without defining it. And many of you have your own experiences, your own ideas about what it is. But the Joint Committee for Health Education Terminology has defined health education as a continuum of learning which enables people to voluntarily make decisions, modify and change social conditions in ways that are health enhancing. So a continuum of learning, we will always be learning it. Voluntarily make health decisions, We cannot force someone to change, but we can give them the tools to empower them to voluntarily do that. Everything from the decision making to actually modifying their behaviors. And in some cases, it becomes necessary to change the social conditions in which they find themselves in to actually end up in a more healthy state of being. So that's the formal definition of health education. When most of us think about health education, we are really thinking about the sequential, planned, comprehensive curricula that considers three key topics or key elements. We must consider that what learners know already and what they think influences their health behaviors. So no one comes to us as a blank slate. When we are with our learners, whether that's children, teens, adolescents, or adults, they are already coming with some knowledge and with some beliefs about what it is you wish to share with them. We have to recognize that. Otherwise, our efforts are not going to get very far. The second consideration that we need to keep in mind is that knowledge is necessary, but it is not enough to produce that behavior change. Knowing about healthy behaviors is one thing, but doing them is another. So we really want to make sure that we always remember that and therefore include a comprehensive approach to whatever curriculum it is that we are trying to implement. The third condition that we need to remember in our efforts in health education is that health behavior does not happen in a vacuum. It is not just about that individual that is in front of you, but it's influenced by their perceptions, by their motivations, their skill level in some of the health-related skills, and in their social environment. So we really need to recognize in our sequential, planned, comprehensive curricula that we recognize learners are coming to us with knowledge and with beliefs, that we must include some level of skill development beyond just the knowledge, and that their behavior is influenced by a lot of internal and external factors. So let's just take a look at health education in schools. I think it is pretty reflective of health education efforts beyond schools because things have changed over time. And it has changed because as we provide health education in a certain manner, we learn from that, and we learn whether that's effective or not effective. And we've been doing a lot of things for a long time that aren't very effective. We've really gone from being a knowledge-based curricula to skills-based. In the early days, it was all about knowing the facts. If I could get you to list five consequences of tobacco use, that was good. If you could tell me the six chemicals in a cigarette, that was all I really wanted you to do. Well, what we found was in going through that fact-based approach, people knew a lot, but it did not change their behavior. So that's really where we put that one consideration in. Knowledge is necessary, but it's not enough. We based a lot of our stuff, if we taught the anatomy, physiology, people would do what they needed to do to stay healthy. Not necessarily true. We then moved on to scare tactics. We tried to scare people into good behavior. We tried to build their self-esteem. We thought if they feel good about themselves, they'll engage in healthy behaviors. Guess what? there's no correlation. And then even most recently, we really focus our health education on the current health issue of the day. This month it might be obesity, last year it might have been teen pregnancy, a couple years ago maybe gang prevention, where we pretty much put all our eggs in one basket and that's all we talk about. Again, what we've learned over this historical view of health education is that knowledge is important, but not, it's not enough. That we need to really look at both the individual and their surroundings. We need to move from content, just telling people what they should know and what they should do, to really getting them to enhance their own skills, to feel competent and confident. And when I talk about health-related skills, I'm talking about accessing valid health information, analyzing influences, interpersonal communication, decision-making, goal-setting, practicing healthy behaviors, and advocating for the health of others. So all of that has to balance out with the content. And what I'd like to do is just to give each of you a little health quiz right now, just to make my point about the skills. So there in the comfort of your own chair, room, house, wherever you are, I'd like you to answer true or false to the following statements. It is healthy to wear a seatbelt. It is healthy to eat a nutritious breakfast every day. It is healthy to brush and floss teeth. It is healthy to get 30 minutes of aerobic exercise at least 3 times a week. And it is healthy to get adequate sleep. Okay, easy statements. All you had to do was say true or false to each one. My guess is that most of you said true to each one of those. You know that those are healthy behaviors. Okay, so let's take part two of the quiz. Answer true or false. I always wear a seatbelt in the car. I eat a nutritious breakfast every day. I brush and floss daily. I get 30 minutes of aerobic exercise at least 3 times a week. And last, I always get adequate sleep. All right. So now as you compare part one and part two of your quiz, did you see a difference? As I said, I guess all of you in part one made true statements. You said that they were true. Part two, did you all respond in truth to that? Or did some of you say, ooh, I don't always do that? Why not? What's the difference between quiz one and quiz two? It's the difference between knowing and doing. We all know, but sometimes we don't all do. And we do for a variety of reasons. We may not feel that it's important for us to wear a seatbelt. That's part of your beliefs, your perceptions. I don't really have anything good to eat for breakfast. I'm not really motivated to get up and do anything to make myself a breakfast that I would eat that is nutritious. I don't have time to get adequate sleep. My goodness, I'm working, I'm going to school, I have so many responsibilities. You know, I eat on the run and I get a few hours of sleep a night. I'm busy. You're right, you are. But what happens is all of those behaviors impact you not only on the short term, but in the long term. So it's really a great example of seeing the difference between knowledge and skill. And when we help our learners acquire and become competent in some of these skills, they are better able to engage in some of these behaviors that they already know are healthy. What I'd like to do is show you a video clip that just really emphasizes the importance of skill in health education.
An apple a day is not enough. Don't let me start preaching, but shouldn't the children of the country that's the wealthiest also be the children of the country that's the healthiest? That makes sense. You'd think that would be true. I know I would. I'm just saying, wouldn't you? But that's not the case with our kids these days. Kids' health is declining in all kinds of ways. We need to improve it. We can, and we will. But it starts with thinking of health as a skill. A 21st century skill that you practice. Practice makes perfect. The unhealthy can't hack this. We've got to teach our kids by example every day. And it's tough because people stop listening when they think they know what you're going to say. Like, drink more water. Eat more vegetables, especially the dark leafy green ones. Eat less sugar. Don't drink soda, especially the sugary caffeine ones. Stop watching TV. Go play outside. Go for a run or a walk or a bike ride. Get your heart rate up every day of the week. Chew your food more. Eat slower. Meditate. Sit still. Get your heart rate lower. Set yourself a health goal. It doesn't have to be wild. It takes a lot of things to raise a healthy child. And healthy kids do better in school. They have better jobs. They lead better lives. They marry healthier husbands and healthier wives. Good health is a skill, and teachers need to teach it. Now you got me preaching, so I might as well preach it. Health is not a one semester class you take in middle school. It should be a part of every subject. Not the exception, but the rule. Learn about good health in math, in English, and in social studies. Work on a project about nutrition in science with your buddies. And parents need to be involved too. Teachers can't do this alone. Good health starts at home. We need to own this issue because the stakes are high. What does it matter if we try to increase our scores in math and reading if scores are dying before their time because they got fatter and fatter? Healthy students make wealthy earners, not to mention better learners. The choices you make every day have the biggest impact in the biggest of ways. Check it. Why else would they say an apple a day keeps the doctor away? But new solutions to old problems, that's the American way. Who cares about keeping the water clean and pure? There isn't a problem if they can't sell you the cure. Don't keep looking for new technology to be your medical savior. Of course, it's easier to be saved by a miracle than it is to change your behavior. So we need to value health education the way we value math and reading. We can't keep feeding our children the same old lessons like junk food full of saturated fat and sugar and chemicals. We can do better than that. We can and we will. And that's the truth, because the future belongs to the healthy youth. Amen.
All right. So, a fun way to look at the importance of skill building in health education. And really, that's where we find ourselves in the field today, is that we are really looking at how do we incorporate those skills, how do we balance that with the content, with the knowledge that our learners may need. I haven't seen any comments come in yet, so I want to encourage you once again, either call or email a response to my question: which one or two health standards do you feel are critical to include in your classroom, in your work with others? So hopefully you'll get that as we go through some of these. What I'd like to do in the next few minutes is to present to you a little bit of information about the health education content standards. In an effort to help you meet one of the objectives for this set broadcast, where you should be able to summarize the content and skills included in these standards. So let's talk about these health education content standards. These were developed at a national level several years ago leading agency, and that was the American Cancer Society. And since that time, states have taken these national standards and personalized them to their own state. We'll talk a little bit about California's as we get into the discussion. What you are reading in your textbook is aligned to the national standards. So I'll point out as we get through some of them where there is a modification, not too many major differences. But these standards were adopted in California by the State Board of Education. So they really provide guidance on what we do in schools. But standards in and of themselves are really about identifying what students should know and be able to do in health education. So let's talk about our first health education standard. And that's what's called core concepts. All right, so when you think about core concepts, what does that word core mean to you? Core generally means the heart of it. Some folks will say the meat of the matter. In California, instead of core concepts, we call them essential concepts. But whether you call it core or essential concepts, we are talking about the foundational functional knowledge that individuals need to have about health. So it's foundational, it's functional knowledge. And when we talk about, oh my gosh, in this world, what all do we need to know? There are a broad range of health issues that are addressed in health education. So our next visual, if we could have that, there we go. And if we could bring that full screen. This visual identifies in the center those health issues that are included in health education. So let's just go around, starting up at the top with personal and community health, mental, emotional, social health, nutrition and physical activity, injury prevention and safety, alcohol, tobacco, and other drugs, and then growth, development, and sexual health. Now, those may sound familiar to you because that's how I've organized the course syllabus. We will be addressing each of those content areas over the remaining weeks in the class, really looking at how do we teach not only this functional knowledge, but the skill development necessary for our learners to engage in healthy behaviors. So that is that all of the knowledge that we need about health can pretty easily be organized in those six content areas. Okay, but we said functional knowledge is not enough. We have to go on to skills. So when we look at the skills in the health education content area, or in health education, this is what you find. Accessing valid information, analyzing influences, goal setting, decision making, interpersonal communication, self-management, and advocacy. All right, so we've got all these skills. Well, we've got one standard for content, the core concepts or essential concepts, but within that one standard, there are six content areas. And then on the other hand, we have seven standards that are focused on skill development. So what we really try to do is we need try to balance content and skills. We have the one content standard over here on this side, and then the skills standards. So let's take a look at each of those skills. We will pick up, because what we want to do is we want to teach the skills as we teach the content. So let's take a look first at analyzing health influences. Analyzing health influences, and this is a visual representation. If visuals help you, remember as we talked about how the brain works, some people work with visuals. Some of you will remember AFI or AI, analyzing influences. But what I want you to walk away from when you are reading, when you are hearing about health influences, is that there are two categories of health influence. There are the internal influences, what we think, what we feel, what we perceive, and there are external influences. Our family, our friends, the media, our culture, our income level, the communities in which we live. So there are all these influences around us that we have to take into consideration as we think about our health behaviors. And we have to understand that those influences, they're very complex. It's a very complicated issue. If I'm thinking about, I have this headache, I need to go get some type of pain medication. Okay, how do I decide what to do? What do I pick? Is it based on what my mom always gave me? What is in the medicine cabinet at home right now? What's on sale? The advertisements, the packaging, all of that plays into my decision to take some type of medication or choose some type of meal in a restaurant or engage in some type of health behavior from washing my hands to brushing my teeth. All of these things influence us. And those are the easy things to identify because they're external. The internal ones are those internal feelings about, oh, I'm so tired, I just don't have time to do this. Or, I'm gonna look like a real nerd if I go brush my teeth at lunchtime. Everybody's gonna laugh at me. I will be more accepted by the group if I go out and drink with them. Or if I have a smoke, I'll look more grown up. It's all that self-talk that all of us have to listen to. Those are those internal influences. And when we are thinking about changing our health behaviors, we have to think about what those influences are and how we're going to deal with them. Okay, the next skill that we need to keep in mind as we think about effective health education is accessing valid health information. Some of you will remember AVI, some of you will remember this little icon, the book. This is really helping others learn how to access valid information, how to find the source of information, how to explain what it offers, and how to judge whether or not it is a good source of information. This is going to be critical to each of you as you evaluate websites for one of the activities in class, one of your assignments on the discussion board. Also, as you even look at some of the curricula that you'll be writing about on a couple of your discussion board assignments. So do keep in mind this particular skill. You're going to actually get to use that while you're here in class. Do know that there is mention of it in the text. I've also posted for you on Blackboard a document called the CRAAP test. And I have a video clip for you now that just reviews the CRAAP test. So if we take a look at that video, I won't have to talk about it. Go ahead and this will be an exercise in reading for you. Thank you. Okay, just a quick review of the CRAAP test. You have the document, and also in pages 110 and 111 in your textbook, you'll find additional information on evaluating electronic sources of information. So keep that in mind. You're going to actually get a chance to use all of that. Okay, so let's go on and just quickly go through the other skills standards. The next one is interpersonal communication. What you will see in the icon are two individuals hopefully talking with each other, communicating. This is where we are encouraging our learners to have a two-way conversation, to be respectful, to be clear in their statements, organized, paying attention to verbal and nonverbal communication. Examples of interpersonal communication in health are everything from how to ask for something, or how to ask for help, refusing an offer to be involved in a health risk behavior, or even negotiation skills. So certainly that is key for much of what happens in our daily lives as we decide whether or not to engage in healthy behavior. We may be asked to do something by another that we have decided not to do. How are we gonna handle that? What are we gonna say? So that's an important one that we will have to look at in curricula and in how we address students. Other skills standards that you will need to look for is decision making. How has the resource or how is our lesson going to include teaching students about the steps in the process of decision making, looking at alternatives and options, looking at the consequences of each of those. How do we get them to the point where they can make a clear decision and then reflect back on it to see if that indeed was a healthy decision? We also want to address goal setting. We want to make sure that our learners know the steps in the process of setting goals, both short-term goals and long-term goals, and that it is critical to evaluate where you are in relation to your goals periodically as you go along. Sometimes we need to adjust our goals. There is also the content standard or the health skill of self-management. Self-management is basically demonstrating that you can engage in a healthy behavior, from the steps of first aid or CPR to how do you manage your stress, how do you wash your hands, how do you brush your teeth. Oftentimes this is referred to as the just do it standard or health skill. And sometimes there is a specific order in the steps and sometimes not. But this is really getting people to the point where they're taking what they have learned, they've analyzed their influences, they've accessed valid health information, they have made decisions, set goals, now they're just going to do it. In California, the self-management goal is actually called practicing healthy behaviors. So a little bit more straightforward in California. The next and final skill slide, or skill standard, is advocacy. Excuse me. Advocacy is the point at which we ourselves as individuals are engaging in healthy behavior, and now we are trying to get others to engage in that healthy behavior. So this is that positive peer pressure. Taking a clear stand for health, being persuasive, being passionate about something, really connecting with other individuals, encouraging them to adopt that healthy behavior. While it is called advocacy at a national level, it is called health promotion here in California. So if you see health promotion, they're just basically talking about advocacy. The key with being a good advocate is that you know your audience and can adapt your message to meet the needs of that audience. Okay, so now we've gone through all of the skills standards, so let's put them all together. And here we have a representation of all of the standards. If we could bring that visual forward, I think it's important for us to see how they all work together. On the bottom, and this visual was designed for the state of California, so it uses the initials for the California terminology for standards, not the national. So don't let that throw you off. We've just been talking about national. Now I'm showing you a state document. Can we pull that forward so everybody can see it? There you go. You'll see at bottom level, that foundation is what we call essential concepts or core concepts. Then we have accessing valid information, analyzing influences. We go up through decision making and goal setting to interpersonal communication. Then we're practicing healthy behaviors, and we are doing health promotion. As we move up and we are able to be comfortable, be confident, be competent in all of those skills as we go up, we're actually increasing our level of health literacy. Knowing about what to do is a very low level of health literacy. Actually practicing those healthy behaviors is much higher level of health literacy, and that's where we want all of our learners to get to, is to be at that practicing and promoting the health in others. All right, so that kind of gives us some logic, some organization around all of the standards. They are not linear, but they are all dependent upon one another. Okay, so we take those standards from the national that were identified in your book. We have then adapted, modified, personalized them to the state of California, and we've ended up with the California Health Education Content Standards. This particular document was approved by the State Board of Education back in 2008, and it is intended for use in public schools, kindergarten through grade 12. It can easily be adapted and used for preschool or for young adult. It can be used not only for schools, but for community-based or faith-based settings, even in clinical settings. Because what the content standards document does is it defines for us what students at particular age groups should know, what is that functional knowledge that they should have, and what should they be able to do as far as health behaviors, or where should they be in their skill development. Certainly this is a guidance document within the state for public education, but it also serves as a guidance document for a lot of folks who are not in schools, but who are working with children, youth, adolescents, young adults. So it'll be a good resource, I think, for each of you. And particularly those of you who are wanting to work in a school setting, you'll want to become particularly comfortable with it. Okay, well, let's take now what this document will provide to us, and let's start to look at how do we take these recommendations, this guidance for what students should know and be able to do, and put them together in some type of lesson or unit or long-term curriculum. And really, a lot of your reading this week had to do with designing your everything from a year. This book is designed for schools, but so that's why they use the yearly planning. But we can always break it down into units and then into specific lessons. The one thing that I would encourage all of you to keep at the forefront of your mind when you are thinking about planning some type of health education activity, lesson, event, etc., is to always keep the big picture in mind. Keep the big picture in mind. What is your end goal? What is it that you want your learner to know and be able to do? That will lead you to developing that lesson, that unit, or that activity that will help get them there. You want to teach to the standards. You know, you take this big picture, and your big picture could very well be the standards and some of the performance indicators that you find in the content standards document. You put that up there, that's your aim, your goal. So now you just have to actually teach so that you can get your learners there. So when you teach to the standard, what does that mean? Teaching to the standard, which is your big picture, you're going to identify what your learner should be able to know and be able to do. You should be able to question, this activity that I want to do with them, it doesn't help them get to that end point. Okay, that's an eye-opener. But then we don't do that activity. We find an activity that does help them get to that. If you are choosing a curricula, some type of instructional resource, you want to look at that very critically and say, does this lesson, does this curriculum, does this unit actually help my learner get to that end in mind, that big picture? If it does, then this is a curricula that I might want to use. If it doesn't, okay, I got to put that one back on the shelf and I have to look for something that does. And here also, you want to think about how much time do you have with your learner? You know, it's one thing to have a class in a school where you will be with your student every day, you know, over the course of that 10-month school year. Or do you have one single encounter, maybe a few minutes? Or do you have 30 minutes with a group during their lunch break? Can you meet with a group once a week, an hour every time for maybe 6 weeks? So that's going to play into how you design your lesson or what curricula you decide to use. Can you really accomplish all that you want to within the time that you have? Most of us plan this unit that would take months to get through. Okay, now we got to break it down. The reality is I only have this much time. So what is critical for this particular time with my learner? What do I need to get across, and how can I involve them enough so that they get it and they take that and they adapt it into a behavior change? And sometimes when you have multiple exposures, you get to see them every week for a month, you can break it down so your instruction fits into your time limit. But that's going to be a critical consideration. So you think about what your big picture is, the big picture in mind, your goal, your end target. You think about how you are going to teach to the standards, what time it is that you have with the learners, and then basically you plan your lesson. You plan your activity. You want to focus on your learners. Who are they? What do they need? You want to share with them what it is you hope that they learn. Just as I share with you the student learning objectives for each week. You'll then plan an assessment. How will your students know what they've learned? How will you know what they've learned? Then you plan the actual active learning activity. So we kind of do some backward planning. And then, of course, at the end of any kind of instruction, you do reflection. The learner needs to reflect on what he or she learned, and you, as the health educator, want to reflect on what you did, what worked well, what didn't work well. So several things to keep in mind as we go along. And these are kind of the steps that we will go through every week as we look at curricula, as we look at some effective strategies to bring health education into some of the encounters you have with other individuals, whether that's in a classroom setting, in a community-based setting, in a clinic, in some type of neighborhood gathering. So I hope that you'll be able to walk away with a fairly full bag of tricks, a bag of good strategies and good resources to use. Okay, so before we end today, I also want to share with you another key part of evaluating resources. We've already talked about the CRAAP test, and that's evaluating that information. You know, is it current? Is it relevant? Does it come from a known authority? Is it accurate? Does it meet your purposes? Okay, we've got that. But we also have to look at curricula from a social content review standpoint. And the social content review is something that is particularly relevant in school settings, because all instructional materials within the state of California that are used in public schools must comply with particular education code sections or law, as well as the school board, the State Board of Education's guidelines for evaluating instructional materials. So I think it's important that all of you know about that document and know about some of the key factors in evaluating it. It will certainly help you as you look at curricula to determine if it's something that would be good to use or not. So if we could go to the computer screen, on Blackboard, I did post a link for the, I'll go here, social content review. So you'll see that you'll click to launch, and you will actually end up in the California Department of Education's website, social content review. When you click on this document here, you will actually see the full document. For today, what I would like you to do is certainly know these 4 points, just as a point of summarizing this document. But I do want you to actually go in and look at specifically what these standards for evaluating instructional materials involve. Primarily, what we want to do is to ensure that all instructional materials used in California in public education meet these criteria. I would also say that these are some of the same criteria I would want to use in any setting, whether you're in schools or in a clinic. You want to ensure that the materials that you are using portray accurately and equitably the cultural and racial diversity of American society. So if you are working with a diverse population, you want your instructional resources and your curricula to reflect that. You just want to be particularly sensitive to instructional resources. And where we find often there's a mismatch is when we are using resources from another country, or we've pulled up an old resource that we think, oh, maybe there's something here we can use. You just really want to look at how does the instructional material portray the diversity of the group that you are working with. You also want to ensure when you are looking at curricula that it demonstrates the content or the contribution of minority groups, males and females, to the development of California and the United States. Now again, remember, this is a document from the California State Board of Education. While it is particularly critical at the school level, we do want to ensure that our curricula does not diminish any of the contributions of anyone. We want to emphasize that people in varied, positive, and contributing roles are in that curricula and that can influence our learners. And we want to make sure when we're looking at curricula that it does not have inappropriate references to commercial brand names, products, and company logos. Don't use a curricula that's a commercial for a company. So those are some things that you will want to keep in the back of your mind as you look at curricula. There is a database on this website, and you can certainly click on it. Do not be surprised, you won't find much. The State Board of Education does not approve all resources. However, I am going to send you a link to the California Healthy Schools Resource Center. And this is a great source for you to learn about some of the legal issues around health education in California, and it gives you free access to a variety of curricula. We'll talk about that probably every week as we go through content. Okay, well, that brings us to the end of our time together. Really take some time to explore those documents on Blackboard. Don't forget your journal entry. Next week is your first exam, so start preparing for that. And until next week, if you have any questions, please feel free to give me a quick email, and I will certainly be able to try to help you with that. Until then, here is wishing each of you health, peace, and happiness. Have a great week. See you next Saturday.